Okay, today I have Simon Philip Wast, Marketing Executive for GE Healthcare's Digital Health and AI Portfolio as our guest. Simon, welcome to our show.
Hi guys, thanks for having me.
Sure. So tell me about GE's Digital Health and AI division. What are you doing?
I mean, look, GE is a big medtech, but I'm also a digital player in the healthcare space. And I'm in charge of what is called GE Healthcare Digital. Think about that, it's software with any kind of healthcare provider. If I would explain this to my grandmother, I always say we help our customers to unlock the intelligence, the data that they have in silos, and then basically use this intelligence to put data to work for healthcare providers. So at the end, provide better care. That's what we do in a nutshell.
Okay, can you give one hands-on example?
I mean, for example, we have our so-called vendor neutral archive, which is a large archive where you can store any kind of data at the end, right? What we do is we bring the data out of, normally data is stored in silos, like in the PACS system in the radiology department, in the cardiology department in the system. We unlock this data by bringing it together, and then we have tools to basically share the data within the healthcare provider to put it at the end where it's needed, at the point of care.
Okay, very good. And what is your job?
Look, I'm in charge of marketing for our cluster that we call Europe, Middle East, and Africa. And I see marketing has at the end four walls. And my team and I, myself, we play four walls within the company. One is we are a strategic partner. So we help to understand the customer, to understand the market, to do the strategic planning. But also we are leading like the key opinion leaders and these kind of initiatives. Secondly, I always think of marketing as a differentiator. So here, new product introductions play an important role in our case. Also, the content marketing, so to create content that can be used by our commercial forces to differentiate our products and fall into this bucket. And the third important one is everything about value proposition creation there. And the third big bucket I call marketing as growth engine. That's the classical lead generation aspect, coming from trade fairs, coming from digital campaigns, coming from webinars. So everything that helps to, at the end, generate funnel falls into that. And the last part is marketing as an enabler. Here we help at the end our customers, our internal customers, the commercial forces to sell better and sell more, right? It's on the one that content marketing and the tools there, but also sales enablement trainings and so forth. And that's at the end what my team and I do day to day.
What's the size of your marketing team and the size of the sales force, approximately?
It depends where you look at, right? It depends by sub-regions. The marketing team is a team of five at the end dedicated people in the region. And then you have got also agencies that support us and the broader team, like a center of excellence. So the entire marketing organization would cope roughly, I think, 30 people around the global team. You put this in there. And then the sales forces is really depending on the region as well. In EMEA, we roughly have around 100 salespeople, if not more, but this depends also by product line, only for the digital portfolio.
Yeah, it's just to get a feeling for the size. And can you give me a proxy for the size and growth of your division?
And growth, it's different how you, depends how you measure that, right? I always talk about key facts that you that we have out there. We have got, for example, 4 million installed devices out there in the world that produce data. If you just take our imaging devices, it's roughly 1 million, and they produce in total 16,000 scans a minute, like medical scans, right? And the biggest, let's say, fun fact I always use to basically give you an understanding of how of the sheer size of our IT solutions. If you would take all the medical scans that we have under management today, it would be twice the size of Instagram, the photos they have under management. That's more or less a size proxy.
Okay, very good. And you already said you're basically in charge of EMEA.
Yeah, Europe, Middle East, and Africa is the region
Okay.
where we play.
So I know that you have different product lines, but can you summarize or simplify a little bit your ideal customer profile?
I mean, look, at the end, these are project purchasing decisions, right? We always have a so-called stakeholder set we cater to, a buying center. But if you see where at the end we focus on, which buying persona, that's the economical buyer at the end. It depends also in which kind of institution you are, but it's normally the CEO, the CIO, and sometimes also a newer concept, which is the Chief Medical Information Officer, CMIO. These are the normal personas we meet day to day.
Okay, and who's the one to basically break into a company? Is it like, do you fly in through the CEO or is it somewhere else usually?
It depends literally by how the internal, let's say, provider is set up. Normally, I would say CEO, CIO are the ones where we enter and where we start the conversation, as we normally look for an outcome and not sell a pure IT device. Right? We go in there and say, like, look, we want to help you to increase throughput by X or something like that. So it's normally the CEO and also the CIO. These are the two ones that we normally enter. Depending on the problem state, but also depending on the product line you are talking about.
Of course, of course. What ARR size are you usually talking about, like annual recurring revenue? Because I assume you have a subscription for most of your services.
It depends. Starts basically with, if you talk about a normal, let's say, business intelligence solution, it's a smaller ticket sale. If you go into an entire data management approach, it's a larger amount, right? This depends really customer by customer. What we do is we tier our customers, right? And it depends literally on what kind of project you have. These are normally larger size IT projects, which are in the millions.
Okay, so media would be in the millions then?
More or less, yeah. The medium.
Okay, now it's just important so that everybody knows in what context the next answers have to be placed, you know?
Okay.
Yeah. Okay, very good. So in the past, a majority of the business was very likely produced by industry trade fairs. And that was not possible in the last couple of months or even more than a year now since COVID happened. So what did you do to compensate?
I mean, you clearly basically touch a pain point here, right? I always would like to say this kind of to show this kind of photo where somebody punches in your face. That's how it felt like when COVID came. I believe I'm not the only one who basically didn't see that coming in this kind of scope, right? And you're right, we had roughly in the past at least 1/3, if not 40% of the marketing spend going into the typical large trade fairs. Like there are several trade fairs that we always basically are part of. Like the HIMSS is one, the RFNA are other ones, depending on the specialty you go. But these were the major investments where we directly talk to installed base customers, but also to new customers. And as you also rightly said, this suddenly was not possible anymore. It feels like a roller coaster where you get just stuck and then it didn't go on. What we did is we doubled down on any kind of other activity that we could, right? It was also a fine line in marketing because you didn't want to be perceived as tone deaf out there, right? You could not just go like, buy from me when you see that basically people are saving lives at this point in time. But if you ask me what we did exactly, we doubled down on things like webinars, social media campaigns, digital marketing as such. These were the first routes where we really deep dived and saw how this was going. And on the other hand, we also engaged in this virtual trade fairs out there, which were also a learning journey, I have to say, because they were used for different kind of purposes. For demand generation, they were not that successful. But yeah, that's what we did on short notice, basically. Doubling down on webinars, social media campaigns, videos, these kind of things.
Okay. On what channels are your customers mainly when we talk about social media?
I mean, look, man, it's all the typical suspected ones, you know, but the ones we used most is Twitter on the one hand, and is also LinkedIn as main channels, as the CEOs basically play there. We also have an Instagram account. We also have a Facebook account, but we didn't use them that heavily for these kind of initiatives. LinkedIn was for sure one of the main platforms that we used and that we are still using at this point in time. So actually, we also engaged into research. This may be an interesting fact for you as well, to see where we all fall short, right, as industry. Because the first trade fairs we had virtually in so-called virtual experiences were moderately successful, right? So we have to understand why that is. And mainly two things came clearly out. One is that the content that is provided there is normally not that differentiated. This was one important fact. The other one, the biggest, let's say, myth was that was stated was that you don't have this kind of networking opportunities you would have in a normal, let's say, environment. And the good thing here is, from a marketing standpoint, you can address both of them, right? In a virtual world, you can actually make more people accessible because you don't have the travel or the tight schedule in there. And content is the other one, which is clearly, I said this at the beginning, under the marketing umbrella, where we had to change quite a lot, but where we also did some things, and I can elaborate on this later, on what we did there to basically fine tune that. But these were the two main things that they told us, look, you don't differentiate in content. It's not that interesting, what all of your providers tell out there. The second one was this networking opportunities, which was basically a miss at this point in time. And that's where we also put our focus directly after we had this information.
So how about you take us on the journey from where all of the normal stuff that you were able to do and that worked wasn't possible anymore. You started the first online events. You saw, oh, okay, doesn't work that good. So just walk us step by step through what data you saw, why you said this doesn't work, and what you did next or the next few steps afterwards.
Mm-hmm. I mean, the first thing which is interesting here is that you keep your normal KPIs as such, but you add new ones, right? That's what we did at least. And you increase also your kind of operating mechanism in reviewing those, right? So we went literally into the past, there was this typical quarterly review. We were at some point actually in bi-weekly, even weekly reviews, where we went through the certain KPIs to see how the normal KPIs behave, right? The first one for us is always leads generated that we looked into on a strategic level. We looked into the second one is then our conversion rate. How do they convert, right? And the third one is how much marketing generated funnel do we actually add to the general funnel of the sales teams, right? And these were the ones that we also reviewed before COVID.
Can we stop for a second? A marketing generated funnel, does this mean like a weighted amount of money that is within the funnel? So people who became, opportunities usually, and you say, for example, 3 million could be revenue, 10% the probability, so we have 300,000 in the funnel. Do I understand this correctly, or how do you do this?
I mean, how we do that normally is whenever marketing generates a lead that comes not from the sales force, right? At the end, the opportunity that this lead creates in value is created to the marketing funnel. And then there's also on top of that, a funnel that our sales force generates themselves, right? Because they go out to the usual suspects, they cater to existing customers. And at the end, the marketing generated funnel is every funnel that comes from a purely marketing activity. Okay. So that's how we define that. But these are the ones that the first things that we changed is we looked at this now bi-weekly, even weekly, not just on a monthly or quarterly basis. And then we defined for each of the activities more, let's say, leading indicators that we can actually look into. How many people signed up? How many registered? How many took part? And how long did they, engaged with the content? This is all new stuff that gives you a wealth of information to then pivot and fine tune and things afterwards. I take always the typical webinar as an example. You normally start with a registration list of, let's make this up, roughly 1,000 people. Then on the day where the webinar happens, you actually only see 350 join, right? And out of these 350, you see at some point in time also people dropping. You can measure that today because either the content is not appropriate for them, it's not the right topic, or so forth. And there you have a lot of information you can use to basically fine tune your activities. So for each of our typical marketing tactics, we generated more information and discussed this in the weekly marketing huddles. And we saw for us that at the end, let's say four things worked quite well throughout that. One is we had to produce more what we call snackable content. Our content was normally too long, a white paper, long interactions, which in today's work, would maybe work if you are somewhere waiting for something, but not in this digital fast-paced world. So we basically shortened our content into basically shorter videos, shorter white papers, infographics, all of these kind of things, what I would call snackable content, things you can easily consume without putting too much of an effort in there.
How short did you get with the content in terms of videos, for example?
I mean, it depends literally. The best engage, it depends on platform. If you are somewhere, for example, in LinkedIn, I would say not even a minute to engage people. If you have these, let's say, more educational stuff, we had a series which was a 60 seconds radiologist, where a radiologist was talking about a certain kind of technique or tool he or she uses within 60 seconds. So these elevator pitches work quite well for us. I would say, then there are other more educational formats which could go to 5 to 7 minutes, right? But that's one of the learnings we had. We also learned that there is, for example, a good thing is a study that you can reuse, right? You can use a graph to tease as snackable content and then have the study with way more information behind that. Mm-hmm. These kind of things we tested. And then new formats like podcasts, for example, depends on your audience. As well, like this format here works for us very, very well as well. Always depending on the decision maker or the subject matter expert you invite, right? But these were some of the things we learned, that this snackable content has to be created and or the current content has to be adapted to watch this format. This was one thing. Mm-hmm. Second thing that was likely the most successful campaign we had in GE Healthcare as a whole was during the times of COVID, we turned our entire social media platforms into a news channel, right? So we had an individual called Mickey Kay, who is a former journalist who also is a US veteran. And he was traveling around the world in times of COVID, telling all the good things happening and not just how people are addressing COVID, not just GE in general, right? He was traveling to all of these different places and we used our social media channels to push this out on a frequent level. It was more like I wouldn't call it Netflix approach, but it was like literally a news channel and not like the typical videos we did in the past. So this turned out to be quite successful as well.
What KPI did you use to say this is successful? Because this is kind of unusual, and usually, I mean, you can put it into the bucket of brand awareness, but it doesn't have anything to do with any of your products. So sales could sometimes say, well, okay, what are you doing, guys? I mean, so what kind of KPI did you align on that you said this was very successful?
I mean, the first thing is you go for viewers, right? How many people watch that? Then we did studies also in terms of sentiment out there and internal people, which increased that. The first season reached like a positive sentiment, I think of 98% or something. We surveyed, as I said, our own professionals to see if they liked that. We had higher employer engagement as well as customer engagement with this content. And so these typical kind of KPIs that you would do on a media campaign applied here as well, right? The typical one is at the end the number of followers, right, that get used or get added to your channels. And I think with the first video series, these short videos, it was something around the 30,000 followers that were added already with the first one. We are now in the third episode. So these kind of KPIs, we our social media team looked quite deep into.
Okay, so with channel, you mean basically the company, for example, LinkedIn channel, and the amount of followers that this channel has.
Okay. I mean, okay. LinkedIn, YouTube, where it was displayed, and then anything else, Facebook. I think we also had some shorter bits of that, mm-hmm. But that's what we looked into.
Okay. Do you also look at, because you already said engagement of employees, for example, on Facebook or LinkedIn? Did you look a little bit deeper into that? Because in the end, each of your, for example, salespeople has a network of potential customers. And if they share something, if they do something, that increases your reach, like I would say, much higher than a few thousand. I want to oversimplify this, but adding 30,000 sounds nice, but leveraging your 100 salespeople, each one has 10,000 or let's even say 1,000 people who are potential clients. And that is a number that is like crazy high then.
I mean, we worked in the past. This was actually point three and point four. I still want to elaborate. One is we created this kind of digital opinion leader network, and we also not just trained, but also beefed up our corporate influencers, our CMO and so on in that. And we used in the past the LinkedIn tool that was provided to basically also called Elevate, which is not around anymore, to spread the word. This was for sure within there as well. And it worked out for us very much, as you just mentioned. On top of that, we trained our sales force in social selling and virtual selling, not just on LinkedIn, also for these kind of virtual congresses out there. But we did this as well. These were two additional, I would say, success layers that we at the end used, right? And at the end, what we did is we, as I said, we created this digital opinion leaders, which could be external, internal, and our own corporate influencers. And we built them at the end a platform. It works like you said. If you bring them together frequently, they start to also develop their own kind of channel strategy, what they post when, how they post, and so forth. And this was for sure one of the success factors here as well. And there we also, what is interesting is, it is not the typical suspect you would use, right? At the end, people follow people. But we had also some, let's say, early adopters, younger generation employees who were quite active. And we didn't always went for the highest one in the org chart. We also leveraged people who are natively doing that as well, right? And that's something for sure, which I would recommend. Look into who these corporate influences could be. You sometimes don't expect it to be the typical one you would use. And then you have to train them, you have to provide them content, you have to also have a content strategy behind that, mm-hmm. and so forth so fast.
How do you provide content to those people? And how is it basically, first question, how do you provide content? Do you use any technology, or is it simple like a Dropbox or whatever? And second, how do they choose the content that they post or change it, or is it pushed out?
I mean, look, we have our own channels where we also push out created content, but that's normally you use existing interviews, existing, I don't know, panels in conferences. Mm-hmm. We train them themselves to provide their content. What you said, it starts with a normal, let's say, training, how to set up your profile, right? And then who you should start to follow, what basically are the do's and don'ts, and also what's against policy, what you should talk about, what not, where are the pitfalls. And then for our, let's say, for our so-called digital opinion leaders, we also provide content, right? We have panels with them together where we film, for example, podcasts, a typical one where we have a good series with our CEO of our command center business, who basically is our star there. He pushes out frequent podcasts with decision makers. But it depends a little bit where you're looking to. But we didn't use a specific technology for that. And if you ask for this, we basically did this. The marketing departments developed that for the opinion leaders.
Very good. And I mean, I assume I know, because I was a management consultant at some point, and also had a pharmaceutical company as a client, which is in the same space at least. You are in touch with medical people, and they are usually quite old school, and which is not bad. It's absolutely fine, but this is like a very fast shift on how you operate. So how did you get your people to adapt this new style of engaging with social, for example, which is probably something where most people usually always said, like, I know the phrase of, yeah, I've been in this business for 15, 20 years. I know I have to get there. I have to build a personal relationship. They have to like me. We have to talk about whatever. Go on the golf course sometimes. And now you come in and say, no. You have to create content. You have to post. You have to engage. How did you do that?
I mean, one thing is always, first, there was not so much of an option in the last months, right? But you are right, there was this typical question, look, my customers are not digital, which at the end, you can prove wrong if you get people on a meeting. If there's no other option at the end, people will join. What we did is we actually helped in all of these kind of, let's say, ramp up phase. training I just mentioned, education around how you have to position yourself, what basically, how digital tools work and so forth, is one thing, right? But then our team also helped to get these meetings into the agenda, provided the content for these meetings, provided the backgrounds and all of these things that you have that it's kind of standardized. This was one factor. Then you have to celebrate your successes. So there were some meetings where actually customers and we were in a virtual phase and we are, let's say, the virtual meeting, and you saw people laughing, smiling, and it worked, right? We celebrated this. The typical change management applies as well here. Get your early adopters in and tell them to spread the word, right? Get also your leadership to lift the talk here, right? So everybody had to use cameras, everybody had to use the technology around this. So we have not the meetings where, you should use every virtual, let's say, tool you can. You can see people, you can hear people, right? You cannot touch people in a virtual environment yet, but that's what we also made happen. That's one of the things. And look, that's about it. I think it's not, at the end, COVID helped with that because you couldn't do it in another manner. What I believe will change is that there will not be a black or white. I think it will always be a kind of gray approach in the future. You will have virtual formats and you will have also still the face-to-face engagement in the future. But how to balance this will be very important because both have pros and cons, I think.
Yeah, absolutely. And I imagine you also saved a lot in travel costs and fares and all this. I mean, you don't have to blast it out, but still you have some room for some wiggle room, so to say, to test some things, to see if some things work and some things don't work. And then to decide also what you want to keep on doing and what you want to stop doing. How do you see basically this shift to going back to these fairs? Like, let's assume old school was mainly fairs. Then COVID came, it all had to shift online. And now we go into the future again. If you would guess now, and of course nobody knows how it will be, but if you would guess, how much money would you put into each of these buckets?
I mean, it's an interesting one because we are already starting to have this kind of hybrid formats wherever we can have them, right? There was just recently in June a big congress in the Middle East called Arab Health happened in a so-called hybrid format. So we just decided to bring certain kind of key customers under all of the, regulations and security you can do together, and all same on the GE side. So vaccinated, tested, these kind of things. And on the other hand, we had a fully virtual, counterpart to that as well, where we streamed things live into the world. I believe that people will go to conferences again because this networking part is difficult to achieve, right? This even in a virtual setting, you can start to do better networking by putting people together and having certain kind of workouts online with technology, but it's still not the same as being in one room, right? So I believe this will come back slowly again. But I always believe that there will be a hybrid component to these events. And I tell you why, because you can what we saw is that any virtual event was way more international than it would have been as in person, because people can now join. Time zones is maybe the only restriction here, but we saw, for example, in European online conferences, people from Asia, people from USCAN, from US Canada joining. So people will do this again. So you can connect even more people if you use a virtual space. Where I would put my money, that's an interesting one. You were right, in the past, these, let's say, physical events were a big cost ticket to the marketing budget. And not always fully, let's say, justified, because it was this kind of feeling, the bigger, the better. The more I show, the more space I occupy, the better I'm perceived, which I believe is not the case anymore. I believe that still content, what you provide in terms of is a key thing here. Being in the scientific program will be important. Having symposia, which are targeted with a certain amount of people, will be the future. and having then this in person, right? Where it becomes a little bit again also a priority to get there, right? And then you will have a virtual format or this hybrid format that then is basically streamed out for a larger population. So I believe it comes back. Where I would put my money, that's a good question right now. It will be hybrid, I know that. If I would put more on virtual, less on in person, time will tell. Let's call it like that.
Okay, fair enough. We probably would have to have another conversation in 1 year, and then you can give us some more data.
Let's do that.
So,
it's interesting. I mean, I sometimes you for sure feel the same. You are desperate to again engage in these kind of activities, but this COVID pandemic is not over, right? And that's the kind of fine line we will have to basically address in the near future.
But in the end, it opened up new chances. And if you are faster than the competition and you do things online better than the competition, it's all about getting the eyeballs of your customer on what you're doing and getting them engaged with you and getting into conversations. So, it's a big chance too. And if you're faster and better, you will win market share in the end. I assume you will.
As I said, for me, my big learnings here, the first thing was around the content and the format, how you provide it, right? This had was an important one that we addressed. This was one of the bigger ones. And this so the second thing is at the end, coming back to the kind of on the front lines campaign, also the storytelling you use, right? How you package your content is the second big question you have to solve. And as you said, in an industry which is quite conservative, you have to find a way. And then even in a crisis where you don't want to be perceived as tone deaf, marketing to your target group, that's what I believe are the right things to do, to find the right content and package it in terms of storytelling, in terms of new formats like this, turning your social media channels into a news channel, this could work, right? And as you said, it's a learning curve as well, right? You have maybe the right to experiment more than ever, right? Because the typical ways do not work in the current environment.
It's a testament that, for example, social marketing and selling is something that even works in such a old school environment where most people would have thought, these medical professionals, they are not on LinkedIn. Huh? But in the end, some subsegments are, maybe some not, but some are, and you have to be where your customer is. And if he or she is on this channel and maybe some others, you have to attack those channels in an efficient way. And as you said, also tailor the content in terms of length and maybe in terms of the content itself so that it fits to the channel.
Yeah. Plus, I would say that don't underestimate also the change in the decision-making process that is happening right now, right? So in the past, it was very much clinical driven, everything you do. Right now, hospitals, CEOs don't have to be doctors anymore. They are coming from the, let's say, business administration part of the house. And these individuals, yes, they are in LinkedIn, quite active, right? And also the second phase is that it's basically at the end, a view of the entire working population in healthcare as well, which are all not let's say older decision makers. So there's also a shift happening, and this applies for healthcare as well, maybe a little bit slower than it would be in other industries.
Yeah. So let's shift totally new question now. What does sales and cooking have in common for you?
I mean, yeah, you are referring to a certain kind of way of selling that we rolled out, what we call at the end sales place in our world. And this is basically, I always sell this to our internal stakeholders as easy as cooking. We give our sales force basically a recipe, we give them all the ingredients, All the cooking they have to do themselves. We show them how this would work, but they have to do that. And how this looks like at the end, you provide your Salesforce basically with a clear description of the target, right? The CEO of the needs of this individual, what he or she is looking for. Then you also provide them with the questions they can ask to first basically trigger the discussion about a certain solution you want to sell.
Can you give an example maybe of such a question or questions? Just so that
at the end, let's take in our case, our artificial intelligence orchestration engine. This helps you to implement various algorithms seamlessly into the workflow of a radiologist. There you have got basically various triggered questions that helps you to determine if a radiologist would need something like a solution like that, right? It would be how many algorithms are you using today? If it's in the range of 3, you can handle them. If it's in the range of 15, it gets more difficult, right? So this would be a question where you say like, please go out there and ask these kind of triggering questions. This was one that we did, right? We said, look, how many algorithms are you using in your radiology department today? Where, in which specialty are you using them? In like, let's say difficult exams or in let's say more standardized exams? These kind of questions, we provided the list of up to 10 that salespeople could ask to basically have the first interaction point. Then when the answer was positive, we also showed them, please use this collateral. Could be a study, could be a video, it could be to then engage further with the individual. And the next step would be send them this kind of outcome proof where we basically show that it's working, right? So we gave them step-by-step a recipe of how to approach a sell for a certain kind of product line. And we had this through our main portfolio items. On the other hand, we expected basically from our sales reps that they are also following this kind of guidelines and put actively the steps into the CRM to understand where we stay and what works and what doesn't work to fine tune, right? And this is how we run that kind of demand gen activity.
Okay. Let me recap and you tell me if I understood it right. First part is discovery questions to find out if there is a problem or a need. Second one, you give some value for free, some collateral, something that, and that's something where I didn't quite get what is this collateral exactly. Like, is it like something proprietary from GE where you say, hey, see, here's a study that we created, or what is it? Can you give us a hands-on example?
Could be anything. Could be a white paper that we developed. It could be a video where one of our key opinion leaders talks about this kind of product or solution. Could be a training course that we have. So this is a wide range of things. But
it's already about your product.
It's already about our product. Exactly.
Okay. So it's basically teaching your potential customers about the value of your product already.
And showing the outcome at the end.
And showing the outcome, yeah.
The only thing that I didn't mention is we provide our Salesforce with targets, right? With a targeted database that they go out somewhere where we tell them do that kind of activity, right? So this target exercise is also part of this, but it's not something where I didn't elaborate deeper on, right? So
I just went to the recipe.
But the ingredients are on the one hand, the target.
It's like first you have to, as a cook, you have to ask, are you vegetarian or do you eat meat or fish? It's basically segmenting your target group. Once you have the segment, you know this is a vegetarian, for example, someone who needs this kind of product. You go up there and ask these certain questions to determine what kind of need they have. Then you send a collateral, as you said, which is providing value, but especially around your product. And the last and piece
next step then would be to basically engage in a demo and the rigorous follow-up, right? We literally followed up with the sales force in a frequent operating mechanism each week. Did you do that? Where do you stand? What did you learn? To also say like, look, for this kind of, let's say sell a white paper works, for this it doesn't, there we need more educational video, whatever that is, right? But we also went through this kind of which content works, which doesn't in a frequent, let's say, iterative process with our Salesforce.
Yeah, it's very data-driven. I like that a lot because what we also always tell our customers is we don't know what works, but we can help you test towards success. And in the end, you have a framework like you have, but you don't exactly know what kind of ingredients basically work at which step. And if you test it fast and efficiently, you either learn that you're totally wrong with the target customer and the product, or if that's not the case, which in your case for sure is not the case, then you get better and better over time. One key thing that I learned when I was working in this biotech, or helping this biotech company, it was like basically a sales organization for the DACH region, is that it's kind of hard to get salespeople open up and really put data into the CRM that is true. I mean, the one thing is, in theory, you're absolutely right. Yeah, it's a perfect word. People put in exactly what they did. You can see it, and then you can measure and tell them, okay, you have to change. In reality, salespeople are kind of, always a little bit, they don't really trust, because they have some bad experiences, one must be fair, and then some crazy stuff happened because they put in the data, and then they stopped. So how did you address that?
I mean, look, sales for sure, you're referring to this control, let's say, function of a CRM system, right? Which, to be honest, it is also part of a CRM to do that, right? To look how are things evolving and to track, let's say, sales performance. What helps to engage is that you we put everything into one place, right? This kind of guide I just went through, and our content management system is part of our CRM. So you see it on the first view. You have everything in one place. This for sure helps. A second thing that helps is that you run your, that helped us is that we run our operating mechanisms out of these tools. We don't use PowerPoint or an additional, let's say, Excel file to go through things. We use basically the CRM or a visualization engine on the CRM to measure these kind of things. This also helps for sure. And anything that at the end is perceived value for the sales rep in the everything where you can make their life easier basically helps as well. So this includes, again, training is a big one here. Also being hands-on yourself. So I know perfectly as a marketeer how lead management works in Salesforce, how opportunity management works in Salesforce, and so forth. But look, the challenges are similar, right? It's not, this is for us a commercial hygiene factor that you implement at the end also through a kind of rigor in the sales process, right? So our sales leaders, they basically work hand in hand with marketing here. And we have a third component, which is our commercial excellence function that helps to ensure that these systems are used and are at current, let's say, state of the art in terms of data. But I think it's a challenge everywhere, not just in this DACH biotech company that you mentioned, right? What I always try to do is, if you focus on the value add for the sales reps, and there is some as well, they have information about their customers, they have the kind of collateral in one click, people get more collaborative. Right, it's always a give and take. You have to show them where also value is in for them. But there is also this rigorous process where you have to say, if it's not in the system, it doesn't exist for us as a management function. Right, that's a little bit this kind of back and forth you do there. But look, I'm not saying that all of our sales reps are perfect there, but it is a challenge you can for sure address if you also show the value that is in there. That's how I would respond to that question.
Okay, perfect. And out of curiosity, like, if I were a sales rep, how often do I get training in a quarter? And how often is someone maybe going on a, like, I mean, now it's not possible, but I know from experience in this biotech company, you get accompanied by your account executive or by someone else from time to time and get some feedback. So how does it look like for you?
Look, for me, we have a so-called sales enablement function. Right, and they are they train basically two things. One is on products. Trainings are quite frequently. In our setting right now, these are virtual sessions, or in the tool that we use, where you can do like self-paced learning. Right, you can go in there and consume whenever you want to. That's one thing on the product side. And then
second. You say quite often. Is it like once a week, once a month? What is it?
So depending on the product side, we have for sure once a month of training, easily, if not twice a month. Depends whenever. Look, we have a calendar throughout the year, like an educational calendar, where we have each month for sure a training. Then in front of the kind of bigger trade fairs, this spells up. So there it could even be weekly. What we where the, let's say, the magic lies, what is optional and what is a must-have training, right? There you because training is one thing, but you also have to take into account that a sales rep has to go on sell, has to do the commercial hygiene, the CRM. So we distinguish between optional and also must-haves, right? And that you have to do, which are also then tracked. But we created this kind of self-serve tool as well, where you as a sales rep can go in if you want to deep dive. And that's actually also a beauty of the virtual world, that it's not just once in the time and then the training is done. You can basically record everything and distribute it and even put it into chunks and make it more digestible, right? So that's what we try to do. We had also, when it was still able due to COVID, we had always a commercial week where we brought our people together once a year to network, but also to train them. This, everybody's desperate to retake this, but and then we have a kind of Friday evening power seller format, which is for your own consumption, where we always train certain kind of things which are not mandatory. You can join and join if you have the time and want to learn about these things. Okay, that's how awesome. We have a training calendar throughout the year, where mainly product trainings. We have twice a year, we have this also sales trainings, where we either do storytelling, or we do social selling, these kind of things. That's about it. And we have an OpMac with the team, with the entire sales team, where we, what we call a commercial community call, which we from time to time also use for either training purposes or these kind of things. It's more bringing them together every second week to share best practices and to address, let's say, topics for the entire sales force in India.
Mm-hmm. Awesome. Thanks a lot, Simon. So we are already at the end of our session. I have 5 rapid fire questions for you.
Okay, sure.
Are you ready?
Ready.
Okay, let's do this. What do you do to keep body and mind fit and sharp?
Look, a big bike fan, everything that has 2 wheels and doesn't run on gasoline, I appreciate. So as often as I can, I go out either to drive my road race bike out there or even to the mountains with a mountain bike. That's what I enjoy most, where I can completely disconnect.
Awesome. Is there a business book that you like a lot?
Many. There are many. I mean, one that as a healthcare marketer, I can only recommend to people is If Disney Ran Your Hospital, from Fred Lee, a big one. And currently I'm reading Virtual Selling from JetBlue, which is maybe also important for today's conversation. But these are the 2 ones that come to mind. I mean, there's so many, but these are the ones I would recommend.
Mm-hmm. Is there a business leader that you follow?
Simon Sinek on the leadership side as such, and Eric Topol in my sector in digital healthcare. He's like the godfather of digital health. So these are the 2 ones that come to mind.
Okay, very good. Who should be our next podcast guest and why?
I mean, if you can get somebody like Eric Topol or Simon Sinek, I would be interested in that. But look, there are for sure some candidates I see. Bertel Omnesco would be one with a future within healthcare I would love to hear. These 3, yeah.
Okay, cool. And now you can directly address our audience, anything that we can help you with.
I mean, look, guys, if you're interested in healthcare innovation, feel free to reach out. The best format is normally LinkedIn. Everything, if you value a discussion about digital health or like to hear about that, feel free to connect with me.
Yeah, so you can find, we put your link into the show notes, but you can find Simon also by just looking for Simon Rost, R-O-S-T, Rost. So that's it. Thank you so much for being on our show, Simon.
Great to having. Thanks for having me, Sammy.